So I own three different Vanguard ETFs and I have shares of the Vanguard S&P 500 ETF, Vanguard All World ETF and the Vanguard Emerging Markets ETF. So if you go to the Vanguard's website and look up these products, you can see precisely how much dividends these ETFs pay and how often. So starting with the Vanguard S&P 500 ETF, it currently pays a dividend yield of 1.14%. So Vanguard distributes the dividends every quarter. The most recent payout was on June 17 and they paid 22 cents for every Vanguard S&P 500 ETF share you have. So in my case, I have 1484 shares of the Vanguard S&P 500 ETF. And therefore, I received 1484 times 22 dollar cents. So if you enter that exact dividend amount and multiply that number by your shares, you'll see an exact match of the number of dollars you received. At least in my case, it's correct. So in short, I received $336.12 in the second quarter of 2021 for owning 1,484 shares of the Vanguard S&P 500 ETF. But the thing is, I have a so-called custody profile at the broker I use, meaning I need to pay some cost to my broker when I receive dividends. So the costs are 3% to 10% plus 1 euro of the total dividend income received. So in other words, for that $336.12 in dividends I received, I paid $11.27 to my broker for having a custody profile. When creating an account at the broker I use, you can choose for a basic or a custody profile. On the broker's website, it describes a custody profile as follows. A custody profile is different from a basic profile in that the securities are held separately from the lending pool of the Giro clients' securities and are thus not subject to securities lending. So because I have a custody profile, I pay fees for receiving dividends. And while researching this topic for this video, it got me thinking that I might want to select different ETFs to invest in than the ones I currently invest in. For instance, you can choose to buy an ETF that's accumulating dividends or distributing dividends. So with the accumulating ETF, the difference is that the dividends are automatically reinvested and therefore I don't pay these fees. So there won't be the distribution of a dividend in the accumulating ETF. For example, Vanguard offers you two options for buying the All World ETF and the S&P 500 ETF. You can buy the accumulating ETF or the distributing ETF. So I didn't really look into this before, but looking at it now and doing the math, it might be wise to start buying the accumulating ETFs so I won't have to pay those fees. But I'm not sure yet. I'll need to look into it a bit more to find out the actual benefits and drawbacks. Anyhow, on July 1, I also received dividends from the Emerging Markets ETF and the All World ETF. So the All World ETF pays a higher dividend yield than the S&P 500 ETF. The All World ETF pays 1.43% in total in dividends per year. So the last dividend distribution was $0.58 per share. And I currently own 245 shares of the All World ETF. So on July 1, I received $48.82 from the All World ETF. And then there is the Emerging Markets ETF, and they pay the highest dividend yield from the three ETFs I own. So the Emerging Markets ETF has a current dividend yield of 1.77%. And I currently have 105 shares of this ETF. So the last dividend payment was $13.66 from the Emerging Markets ETF. So did you know that some companies pay dividends and some don't? For example, the Vanguard S&P 500 ETF currently holds 507 different US companies. So the top companies in this ETF are Apple, Microsoft, Amazon, Facebook, and Alphabet, which is the parent company of Google, and Berkshire, Warren Buffett's company. So a company itself can decide whether they want to pay dividends or not. Looking at Apple's dividend payouts, you can see that they are similar to Vanguard, also distribute dividends 4 times per year. So Apple's average 4-year dividend yield is around 1.46%. So the last time Apple distributed dividends, they paid 22 cents for every share of Apple you own. Do note, people who are focused on buying high dividend stocks won't buy Apple stock, since Apple isn't a high paying dividend stock. People buy Apple because they believe its stock price will continue to go up in the future. For example, you find the company Coca-Cola on the list of dividend kings. To become a so-called dividend king, you need to be a publicly traded company that has increased its shareholders' dividends every year for at least the past 50 years. So this year, according to Time.com, there are 31 dividend kings. Coca-Cola's annual dividend yield is currently 3%. So for every Coca-Cola share you own, you'll receive $1.68 per year. So same as Vanguard and Apple, Coca-Cola is also distributing their dividend every quarter. That 3% though is double the amount of the Vanguard All World ETF and almost triple the amount of the S&P 500 dividend yield. Last month, I started writing a full blog post on my website all about my financials of that month. I write about my income, my expenses, my business and everything. So in a blog post, you'll see that I have around $150,000 in Vanguard ETFs at the beginning of this month. So my actual investments are in euros, of course, but I converted them to dollars for this blog post. So anyhow, what I'm trying to say here is that if I were to have that $150,000 in high dividend paying stocks like Coca-Cola instead, I would have had a different number in dividend yield, of course. So let's do the math, shall we? So for simplicity, let's say I would put all my eggs in one basket and buy Coca-Cola shares. So the current price of a share of Coca-Cola is $57. So $150,000, that's how much I have available to invest, divided by $57 is 2,631 shares of Coca-Cola. So if the average yield of Coca-Cola is around $1.68 per year, then that's $0.42 per quarter per share. So 2,631 shares times that dividend yield of $0.42 per share is $1,105 in total in dividend yield. So if you divide that by 3, then that's $368 per month in dividends. So that's a big difference with my current dividend yields of the S&P 500 and the other ETFs. But then again, of course, the idea of the S&P 500 is that its share price will continue to climb and not so much its dividend yield. Also, Coca-Cola sits in the S&P 500 and in the All World ETF. And the idea of selecting ETFs is, of course, that you're not only solely relying on one company or a few companies. Instead, you bet on the entire market. But maybe there is room for a combination of both. And that's what I'm trying to find out the last couple of weeks. And as you just saw, I'm a big fan of buying well-diversified ETFs, and I'm exploring dividend stocks as well by reading books about it. So if you want to follow along and you want to know more about dividend stocks versus global index funds like the Vanguard S&P 500 ETF, please make sure to subscribe so you don't miss any new videos from me. Please let me know in the comments what your current strategy is. Do you mainly focus on high dividend paying companies or broad, well-diversified index funds like the Vanguard S&P 500 ETF? And lastly, as I just mentioned, I recently started publishing a blog post on my website with all my financials for that specific month. And if you're interested in reading that latest blog post of last month, June, please check it out. I'll add a link to the blog post below in the description. I will also publish the next update for July somewhere in the upcoming week. Thanks for watching this video, my friend, and hopefully we'll meet again next time. Bye-bye.